211 more days to the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. Let's come back to the focus of tonight's show, and that's basketball in a decade in Nigeria. I want to review what the country has done from the year 2010 till date. Basketball, mixed feelings they gave us. The time we're about to get happy, something will go wrong. But it's okay. The D-Tigers, they won. The D-Tigers, they also won. There were times that we look at the league and we say, we've got the quality, but what's going on? There were also factions here and there. Administratively, we still have questions to answer. So I called on the former captain of the D-Tigers, Olumide Oyedeji. He's with us in the studio. Olumide, Merry Christmas. Good to have you on Sports Tonight.
Oh, thank you. Great to be here. Awesome. And let me say a Merry Christmas to the viewers at home. Let me join the millions of the fans for channels. Say Merry Christmas and keep being the best TV channels that you've been in years.
Thank you so much. We can't stop not now. It's all about keeping standards. Merry Christmas once again, Olumide. Good to have you on the show. Let's talk about basketball in a decade in Nigeria. From 2010 till date, has it been a beautiful story?
Probably, I mean, can I just say that we probably just say we'll be on the good time, we'll be on the bad time. And I could tell you categorically that the basketball jumped from 2011, probably in 2009, we had a setback. In 2007, we had a setback. In 2005, probably we had a situation where we came third and played in the Tokyo, also in the World Championship. 2007, we fell short, 2009. So 2010, we couldn't compete at the World Cup outside of the Olympics.
Yeah.
So now 2011. So let me say there's a turnaround for Nigerian basketball. And probably I must give kudos that kind of actually laid the foundation.
What happened in 2011?
So probably, and every single thing that happened in 2011, when Nigerian basketball changed, was all about individuals. Because we went to Madagascar to play an African championship with nothing. So this is a person, the people that sponsor the team. You know, we came in Orlando, there was a lot of drama. Some people were selfish, they wanted to take, you know, but we still like, we have to go. That's why the fact we went to Madagascar, we came third. So that made us qualify to play in a pre-Olympic tournament. So, and at the same time in that 2011, that was the first time Nigeria ever won any gold medal in any men's tournament championship. That's an all-African games in Maputo.
That's right. And that gesture in 2011, was it about total service to the country?
I mean, probably definitely total service to the country or determination by a few individuals that just say, okay, you know what, we have to do this. You know, so he's probably someone who's really did it, who have done it or did it, love to make history. I'll probably give kudos to Coach Ayo Bakare, the first one to take Nigeria to the Olympic, the first one to take Nigeria to World Cup. Did it for women, did it for men, qualified junior championship. So, and it's kind of just been a lot of challenge, you know, up to the level in 2011. I mean, we were in Madagascar. He was not going to sleep. We have to force him, lock him up to go sleep. So, because focus on all those things, but yet, we came third, we lost in the final, in semifinals against Angola. So now we qualify for pre-Olympic tournament, which no African ever qualified in the last 50 years that it started. No African team ever qualified. So people believe it was not going to happen.
Beautiful.
So we went to Venezuela, started in China with training camp without no money. Still all about individuals. You know, so we went there, we went from Russia, from China, started a tournament in China, training camp in China. We went to flew to USA to go play friendly games. From there, we went to Brazil, and that prepared us for Venezuela. So for the, so there, things happened.
It's a lot of sacrifice. That the big one, the London 2012 Olympics, what was the experience?
Probably the experience was a wonderful one, it's a great one. The personality, probably just like I feel like I was the limelight of the, one of the biggest things in my career personally. I've done it all, played in the NBA, played in the EuroLeague, African Championship, Commonwealth Games. I've done every single thing, and two things I haven't done at that time. The first one is playing in the Olympics at the same time, they're touching the Afro basket.
You know,
and so those are the two things, but it was a tears of joy. Because nobody ever believed, that we were going to win. Nobody ever believed that we were going to qualify for the Olympics. Yeah. And we went out there, we shocked the world. Hmm. I mean, we beat Russia, we beat Greece. Yeah. At that time, they were number four, number five in the world. Yeah. Then we came back, we beat Lithuania. Hmm. So we were like number five, between number five, they were ranked between five to seven in the world.
Top 10.
Then, at the same time, we now came back to play against Dominican Republic, either win or go home. So I must give kudos to my soldiers that were just Adede Agunduro, Hafuru Kamino, or Tony Skin, Hagdi Ogo, Alade Aminu. Probably those, I mean, it was just a wonderful team that we had over there.
And you guys sustained that momentum from the London 2012 Olympics, stayed together as a team, went to Tunisia. Then you were longing to touch that Afro basket because you had been in the team for quite some time. How was it winning the AfroBasket in 2015?
Oh, well, winning the AfroBasket, that was great, 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 great. You know, remember I started playing for the national team in 1997? 97, 99, 2001, 3, 5, 7, escape 9.
And no title.
I played 11, no 13, title. 15, no title. I played in the finals four times.
Yeah.
I was like, oh my God. So then touching it, feeling it was something that was great. You know, that was and that was when I saw that a lot of Nigerians, the second time, they all stood up. They never went to sleep, just like they didn't go to sleep during the Venezuela, the qualifiers. Everybody was, now, Nigerian time.
Look at that
now.
Guy. Look at that guy. What were you kicking? What were you kicking?
Yeah, so yeah, let's go. Come on, take it. You know, so probably, you know, there was a lot into that. Even during that time, there's a lot of things going on in the background, a lot of people didn't see. Even this team, I must give them kudos because during this time, there was no money. There was no, it was still the part of individual, you know, sacrificing because that was the time that they couldn't really get money to us. You know what? It was just really, really tough. But part of what made this team is like we had about 8 to 10, 9 players that played in the Olympics. About between eight, nine that also played in 2013. I fell short in 2013. It was ill luck. So, but I mean, you cannot see that. So Alade Aminu, Ike Diogo, those guys out there. Ike Diogo didn't even play.
Yeah.
So and he was just like. Shane Lawa came in, be a beast and doing his thing. It gave us energy. There's a lot of things like everybody thinks things are rosy. It wasn't really that rosy.
The road to success is always difficult.
I mean, difficult.
Just watching that, I feel so good. I got emotional at some point because we waited so long to win that. And how sweet was it that it was Angola that you guys defeated in the final?
Oh, you sweet, sweet revenge. Sweet revenge because, I mean, Angola took that one from me about four times. They took it away in the 99, took it 2003, 2005, 2011. Come on, I said, come on, enough is enough. So let's just, I mean, it's about time.
Yeah.
They've probably been Afro Basket 9 times from 97 to 2015.
Yeah.
Wow. He's like, you know what? This is what they call Ebenezer. I mean, there's nothing else I want to do about basketball. But kudos to those boys, the soldiers. So it was great, great, great. So that's just like the turnaround for Nigerian basketball. That was where it started in 2011, 2012.
Yeah.
Because there was a continuity, which was the same reason why Angola won for a long time. Because you don't change. Between 1997 to 2011, 12, I could tell you like we only bring about two, three players back.
So we kept changing.
But in 2011, 1999, 2001, 2003, we have a lot of on-base players. So they were kind of doing it. It was great. But 2005, we started playing professional, bringing up more.
Yeah.
We have started changing and changing. But they continue to kind of just help us, which was the same thing that happened right now in the female team.
Mm.
So. Then we're coming out. A lot of people say, oh, yeah, girl. I knew that this team were going to win back-to-back Afro Basket. Because this team was a team that were put together in 2016 Olympic qualifying tournament. We had about 10 players in this team, or nine players in this team, that were part of the Olympic qualifying tournament in Nantes. You look at it, that time, they upset Korea.
Yeah.
So Korea was in top 10, and they lost narrowly to or Belarus?
So let me tell you, we just concluded the part of the 2015 Afrobasket, and right after that one, it was the Rio 2016 Olympics. What was the experience?
I mean, probably Rio 2016 was really good for us. You know, the game we played when we beat Croatia, it was one of the powerhouse, the top ranked 20 teams in the world. And the game that we lost in the last 2 minutes against Spain, probably that was probably just a good one as well. Probably one of the toughest game of the Rio 2016. So the level went up, and yeah, I mean, we fell short by a game to qualify for the quarterfinals, but we're the best ninth place team. You understand that the best 12 teams in the world plays in the Olympics.
Yeah.
So Olympics is even bigger than the World Cup. So and it was a great feelings for the players and the country. At the end of the Rio 2016, we jumped from probably being number 23 in the world to number 16 in the world.
Beautiful. It was a good experience. Let's bring it to recent times now in 2019. By the way, congratulations to the D Tigers. They have qualified for the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. I'll wrap up the men's part of that with that one when I talk to Olumide. But Olumide, tell me about the men's basketball World Cup that took place in China. Were you disappointed with the D Tigers?
Probably wasn't. I wasn't really disappointed, but I probably believe sometimes things happen. So we had a chance to beat Russia. We lost the game technically, and things didn't really go well for us. We could have made it to the second round and even just get extra 100,000 Swiss franc from FIBA.
Yeah.
So that would have been just like added advantage, plus sponsorship deal, whatever it is. It was at least what we took out of it, took Olympic ticket out of it. The first one is to take Olympic ticket out. We achieved it. So the probably second one, we want to be in the quarter, in second round. So unfortunately, that didn't happen. But nevertheless, I still give kudos to the players who are out there. You saw how the game was, the game against China. So it was a heartbroken game against China, playing against over in the Wukong Arena in China, very hostile, about 15 to 20,000 people, all noise, and for them to come to come out and win that game is a tough game. So it was, I mean, salute.
That's the world stage. Yeah, let's just hope they get better. And the team, they've qualified for the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. Olumide, I met you on the field and I asked you, what does it take to have a good experience at the Olympics? I want to ask you that question again.
What it takes to have a good experience is preparation. Preparation. So probably even as probably the president of the Nigerian Olympian Association and also chairman of the Nigerian Athlete Commission, which is the which is probably part of what my job is, to make sure these things go well with athlete and with the honorary minister that just came right now with what he just with what he's doing. I hope we can continue that. We can put things in perspective. Though it's better late than never. So, but for right now, to say that 211 days. It was tough. Nevertheless, I believe one thing. You know, one thing I know about enjoying about.
Tell me.
We always perform most times under pressure.
Really?
But, yeah, but we don't want to do that. So let's do things in the right way and the way things supposed
to be done.
To be done. So the welfare of the athlete is very important, and we have to go away from the old colonial mentality when athletes voice their mind out, and you see them being rude. And I did sport. What sport did you do? I did sport in 1970, 1960, 1980.
The times have changed.
The time has changed.
Yeah.
That was only analog, TV, ka. Now we went to UHF, UHF with digital. Now you even say anything.
Yeah.
So we have to move away from the when the that's why in the IOC, athletes are in the heart of everything. Without athletes, there's nothing we're going to administer. So probably we have to motivate these athletes.
Yeah.
There's a lot of ways you have to kind of motivate the athlete. And they're talking about a lot of things. Do they know what it takes to be an athlete? So you can never take a cap. You can never make a carpenter to do a weather job and expect a good result. So until we have a better administration and a better understanding of all these things. So I'm sure we're going to get it someday, somehow.
Yeah.
I believe that we're on the right path.
That's what we hope for. Just quickly explain to me again that you said something about having 10,000 hours of practice time before the Olympics.
10,000. Every athlete, either basketball, volleyball, track and field, it takes you about 10,000 hours of practice to be an Olympian.
That's a lot of hours.
So that means it's not a.
So you cannot go have 5 hours, go have 2,000 and say you want to.
How you want to? Where some people they put 20,000 hours.
Ooh.
I mean, you know, like talent take you somewhere, and it's going to leave you there. Mm. But hard work plus talent, so it's going to take you far. So those things is very, very, and like you talk about the psychology, the nutrition aspect of it, that we have to get the right people to run the sport, who know the sport, because athletes got abused in a lot of ways, mentally, psychologically, emotionally, you know, verbally. I mean, I've been in the place where, I'm not going to name it, we had then an athlete about to compete. You know, I had the coach say, you were cussing her out. Before the girl got over
need,
there,
we don't need
now she, now she, now
athletes.
She done.
She's because psychologically,
But they don't have to know what it
down.
Is. But I believe that everybody have to just put out their good job, their good face. So until we have to also understand, our administrators have to have a better relationship with the athletes, not like organism, like a boss the athletes can avoid, but hear from them. Let them tell you so you have a relationship so you will know what to do.
Yeah, this...
But we don't have that. So they just want athletes to say, go, move.
God.
So that was why a lot of people doesn't understand.
Yeah.
Because an athlete's getting $50, $100 an allowance, and the running, every time getting $1,000 as this. And the you that go out there to go and shop, to go and clap, is getting paid for $50 as an allowance.
Those are the things we have
so
to change.
So those are the things that need to change.
Yeah, I agree.
And at the end of the day, again, the athlete has no retirement benefit. And you are still out there getting retirement benefit because one year of an athlete is about 5 to 7 years of someone who's sitting down in the office.
Your association should look into that.
Definitely.
See what you can do. That's why I'm glad that we've got someone like you there. Let's talk about the women. And I talk about the women with so much pride. How impressed are you with the Tigress?
Oh, well, very impressive, but not today. Mm. I've done that since 2016 when the team was put together. Mm. And I believe you, I'll probably give credit to Patrick Omosagie, who I don't know if you remember that time in 2016. He said, this team I'm seeing right here in Nantes 2016, those are the team, that's the team that can win back-to-back Afro Basket.
That's a promise.
He said
right
it in 2016 because,
because
those are the future. Young, energetic, talented, and about 8 to 10 of those players were still playing now. While the players that were there, some of them did not even make the team in 2016. They were not, but they were called to camp. They didn't make the team. Now they made the team. So, I mean, there's nothing really. I expected that. I'm happy this is going on. All this thing is going on. But we could still done better than what we're doing.
Yeah, because we've got the talent. But I'm glad that the continuity we sustained. And, of course, we put a team together. But let's jump from the one in 2017 and the one again in 2019, back to back. And we loved it. Let's talk about the 2019 victory. With what you've seen, and then them going to the World Championships, did they make progress?
Oh, 2017, I believe that they made progress, but we could have still done better. I'm very happy. That's the first time that the African team got to the quarterfinals of the World Cup in women. And I was so proud when I got to the FIA and the FIBA meeting, like, everybody was Nigeria, we got you from 2016, you got it 2017, we had 2018 World Cup. I mean, I was like, okay, all right.
That's it.
So, you know, but probably because that's a team to put together. So I probably know that because if we had about 2-3 more players to what we had, we have players everywhere.
Yeah.
So imagine we had like Gloria Johnson play WNBA, who were ready to play for us, we were able to get her play. Talking about WNBA All-Star, I'm putting her in that mix. We're talking about 2-3 players. We can still make a difference in that team. So we probably believe we could still do better. But the girls still did great.
They were awesome.
They were awesome. And they made, you're just wonderful.
We love them. We love all of them, all members of the D Tigress. Well done, girls. And keep representing the country the best way you can. Can they make it to the Tokyo 2020 Olympics?
I'm not 100% sure, but I'm 250% sure.
250?
Yeah, because I believe in the team. I know they can do it. I mean, all what we need to do, let's just call a spade a spade. The worst case scenario, we just need to win a game. 3 teams are going to qualify out of their group. Nigeria, Serbia, and USA are my picks. Because I know that we put things put together. There's no doubt. I mean, I would probably just go to bed. But you know what? Never. But yeah. I'm pretty sure and confident that we're gonna pick a ticket to Tokyo 2020.
There's no way we'll wrap up this conversation without talking about the administration of basketball in Nigeria. Well, how shameful are you that we're still not getting it right with the administration?
Whew. Probably my heart bleeds, my tears on my face, and my eyes are soaked with tears because just unfortunately that our basketball, we be talking about internationally. We haven't said anything about local players. So probably with the way we're going on, internationally we're looking good, but we're terrible locally. We totally terrible.
Where are we with the league?
Locally.
Where's the league?
Well, unfortunately, we make it with all these young boys and girls. Okay, yeah, we play Zen and League, eight games for a year. And right here now, and the main one, we play 4 games, 2 weeks. One, we say that we do something. Unfortunately, do we know how many boys and girls that we chase to the street?
Yeah.
Because all of us that we are in this ring of basketball fighting the administrator, how many of our own children that feel what these players feel, including myself, my children, they are not, none of them right here that feel what these players feel. We have players that have not got paid for 2 years that we started this drama. So, but we had a crazy league. Everything was great. Everything was okay. They had a smile on it. Bottom line, the administrative problem here and there. But I just, in a situation where until we put our house together, which is true, and nobody wants to hear the gospel truth, we have a new election that probably the family of basketball are not going to be together. But we need this family to be together for the game to move forward. If we truly love this game, we're challenging every single one of us. If we truly love this game, we truly love this country, and we care about these young boys and girls, and we say that we have the interest in their heart, close the door, look for the way forward for Nigerian basketball,
and
put smiles on the face of these young boys and girls, and do the right thing.
Let's leave it at that. Do the right thing. Olumide, thank you so much for stopping by. Merry Christmas once again.
Oh, thank you. Merry Christmas, listener at home. I hope I'm going to get my chicken.
You will. I'll get you something. Just hang on. That's it.